Today I 3D printed this so I could fly a toy plane with my RC excavator, because we've all seen this clip, and let's be honest, the inner child in all of us wants to recreate that moment, as well as use it to build tiny cabins, cause chaos on your desk, and conquer obstacles.
So as you can see from those clips, we have our work cut out for us, as I want this build to be extremely capable while still being very DIY friendly, so that all of you wonderful folks at home can finish this video inspired and start printing out your own RC excavator, which you can then use to fly your very own toy planes with.
Right, let's get down to business. As one can imagine, an excavator has a lot of moving parts. There's the tracks that allow it to drive around, the rotating mechanism that lets it swing left and right, the boom, the dipper, bucket control, and tons of other components that can be added on, like a thumb. For comparison, the RC skid steer uses 3 N20 motors and some servos. Bare minimum, the excavator needs 6 N20 motors, which I'm already planning on 7 because a thumb is absolutely necessary. Then of course, we better have the capability to add another motor and some servos just in case we want to make any extra attachments in the future. Knowing we need to be able to run 8 DC motors, we can move on to the how. Each one of these DRV8833H bridges can run 2 motors, so 4 of them should be just right. Now individually controlling these 8 DC motors is no small feat, as each one requires 2 output pins from our microcontroller to be able to drive it both forward and backward. My go-to for these projects has always been the ESP32 30-pin micro development board. The problem arises though when you try to take 16 of those pins and use them purely for DC motor control, as not all pins are created equal, so while there are 30 in total, some of those are ground pins, power pins, can't be used while the Wi-Fi is in use, etc. This left me in a bit of a pickle, so what I'm going to try and do is squeeze those 16 pins out of a 48-pin version of that same development board, while still having a couple extra to run some servos and lights. Or option number 2, which I'm far more excited about, is to try something I've never messed with and connect up a port expander to the normal 30-pin ESP32 and see if we can't get it working properly. This could be a great option, as this MCP23017 I'm looking at gives an additional 16 output pins and only requires 2 pins from our development board. Better yet, if you really wanted to, you could daisy chain 8 of them together and I have a whopping 128 outputs. Though that's a bit overkill for our application, so we'll just stick with the 1. For power, we'll of course be using the beloved Phoenix 16340 batteries with a built-in micro USB charger as well as circuit protection. I'll spare you the wiring process, but here's the final outcome. Just look at that beautiful rat's nest of wires. You know what that means, it's time to grab some coffee and write a little bit of code. Though before we begin coding, we first need to address the controller situation for this project. Previously, I set up a web server to run on the ESP32, which you can then connect to from your phone or computer and control the project, which is great if you only have a couple controls. But as we already know, this project doesn't just have a couple controls. So I'm going to experiment and see if I can't connect up my old, crusty PS3 controller, which after doing some research, could be a great way to go as they're inexpensive and I'm sure a lot of people already have a couple of them just lying around. Plus, there's some great Arduino libraries out there that will make coding this project a breeze. Which it was, at least the PS3 controller portion. What wasn't a breeze was getting the port expander hooked up properly, nor was the 48-pin ESP32 working out great either. But as I've learned in the past, while reading documentation on electronics isn't very much fun, it's always a good idea. So after sitting back down and reading the data sheet on my port expander, truth be told, it was as simple as tying my 2 data lines coming off of the ESP32 to the power rail via 2 resistors. Just like that, I suddenly had motors I could move and lights I could flash. This felt like such a win that I decided to celebrate by starting on the actual 3D design of the model, which I admit can be a bit daunting when you're staring at a blank sketch, but as long as you have the courage to grab that line tool the very first time, it only gets easier from there. An hour or two later, and I had drawn a 2D sketch of what I felt like was an appropriately proportioned excavator, which was then split apart into its different pieces: tracks, cab, arm, body, etc. Now this is the period of the project that I enjoy so much, because this is where it really starts to develop character, and you get to see what you've been scheming up in your mind come to life on your computer for the first time. Or better yet, once you're happy with your design, you print off your first couple prototypes and fit them together. For the track, I split them into 3 main parts to eliminate any extreme overhangs while 3D printing. They interlock and can be secured via a couple screws. The N20 motors then sit inside the actual drive gears and snap into place. The tracks themselves are always a little tricky as the spacing has to be just right for everything to run smoothly. After a couple renditions though, I was super happy with the final result, and actually printing them is super easy and I don't foresee any of you having much trouble with these. Now seeing this drive across my desk for the first time, I have to admit, was pretty awesome. It has more grip than I could have hoped for and can carry a large payload without any issues. Something that I debated for a while on how to go about doing was this swivel that lets the excavator swing left and right. To achieve the actual pivot motion, I created this 52 tooth ring gear as a part of the lower body, and then this 100 RPM N20 motor has a pinion gear that then directly meshes with the ring gear. To keep the two main pieces from sliding apart vertically, the body has this extrusion that slides through the lower frame and locks onto this lower plug. Something to keep in mind are that the track motor wires need to be routed up from the bottom into the cab where they'll be plugged in. This causes an issue because as the cab rotates, the wires will become twisted. One option is to use one of these electrical slip rings, but they're a bit too big for this application, and I want to keep the parts list required as simple as possible. So the simplest solution I could think of was to make a tall vertical shaft for the wires to run up and would allow them to twist around each other multiple times before causing an issue. The caveat to this is that when you're done using the excavator, it's a good idea to flip it over and hold swing left or right until the wires fully unwind. This has honestly worked out great so far and I haven't had any issues. With the base of our model created and a mounting platform established, it's time to integrate all of our electronics. But there's no way I'm going to try and just shove this rat's nest of wires onto this platform, nor would I expect any of you to do that either. So I hopped into a PCB designer, laid out all of our connections, routed the traces, and admired the final result. With that, I hit the buy now button, and less than a week later, I had them in my hands ready to test. The beauty of these printed circuit boards are that it takes this absolute mess of wires and squishes it down into this nice, neat little board, where all you have to do is populate the headers, terminal blocks, and battery holders, which, if you're a little handy with a soldering iron or willing to learn, is relatively straightforward. For those of you looking to make this project yourself, these are really what make it possible, as it's pretty much just plug and play. With our circuit board populated and mounted, I, of course, took it for a little test drive, then I 3D printed the rear cover, along with some other bits to add more character. Now I can finally start working on what makes this project so cool, the arm. To get the actual motion, I'll be using some of these threaded N20 motors because they're durable, inexpensive, and surprisingly powerful. To mount the threaded N20 motors to the arm, I designed this case that's really easy to print and the motor can slide right into. The wires are then routed through this separate piece, which acts to fully lock the motor in place. The reason for the case at all is that the motors need to be able to pivot just slightly as the booms come in and out, so they're mounted via one screw on each side that it rotates around. Now to turn the threaded rotation of our N20 motor into usable movement, I created this little push rod that houses a 4mm nut that is then threaded onto the N20 motor. With both ends secured, you get this super awesome in and out motion. This was also the moment I realized that the original 300 RPM motors I ordered were way too slow. So instead, I opted for some 1000 RPM motors, which had a nice usable speed while also maintaining a very respectable amount of power. When I say respectable power, I mean this thing can easily pull up all of its weight and then some. Before going further, I broke down and finally added on the cab, which definitely made this project look more like an excavator and less like the Mars rover. Plus, even with just a stub for an arm, this thing can already climb on top of boxes like a champ. But back to finishing the arm. The actual design of the boom and dipper isn't too crazy, though I will say out of everything, these will require the most support when 3D printing, as there really isn't any way to get around that due to its sloped design. It's not bad though, and I've had great success thus far. To route the actual wires coming from the dipper and bucket, I extruded these holders they can then go through. To eliminate any rotational stress on the wires, I made this large pass through that a rotational cuff can be slotted into, allowing for wires slash servo plugs to go through and experience the smallest amount of movement, even when the boom is going from full up to full down. It took a little bit of tinkering to get the 1000 RPM motor to perform adequately for the bucket control, as it was still a little slow, but I ended up moving the rotation point in just a little so that the same movement from the N20 motor resulted in more rotational movement of the bucket, if that makes any sense. You'll also be pleased to see I incorporated the same quick swap attachment plate design from the skid steer into this build as well, which makes swapping between a small bucket and a really big bucket a breeze. Alright, now for the thumb, which I've been planning on from the beginning because let's be honest, this little guy probably isn't going to be an earth mover, but it can sure be a desk clutter picker upper. But the bucket by itself can struggle to get the leverage on something to actually pick it straight up, unless it's these perfectly placed small purple blocks inside this perfectly placed bowl, then I can move those all day. But that's just not good enough. So instead, I delved into the dipper design to see if I could mount another motor somewhere, which this one ended up being a bit challenging as there just wasn't a lot of room to mount the motor itself. I ended up changing some of the overall dimensions on the dipper, which allowed me to squeeze it in while still making the arm solid. The actual mechanism is very simple. The thumb pivots from the same point as the bucket, and it's connected via the threaded pushrod coming off this motor. In testing this design, that thumb has a lot of power behind it. In fact, I broke at least 6 different prototypes before I made something strong enough to handle the peak power. Long story short, this little guy has enough juice to partially crush a can, so I'm pretty happy with that. Not to mention that because the bucket and thumb controls are separate, you can get pretty much any angle you need to pick something up. One last little addition I made were these cab lights because, well, lights are always a crowd pleaser, and on top of that, I have an entire extra slot to add some boom lights in the future. I debated on how to lay out the controls for a while, but ultimately decided that I wanted the two joysticks to mimic real-life excavator controls, which I ended up going with ISO, also known as CAT controls, meaning the left joystick controls the rotation and dipper, and the right, the boom and bucket. Then on the front of the controller, the triggers and bumpers control the tracks, which I actually like a lot as it gives you full control, meaning you can either move both tracks or just one for a little bit of movement. Then finally the thumb, in and out is the up down arrows on the D-pad, and to toggle the lights on off, you press the left joystick. Now that we have the excavator finished, I think it's time we set some benchmarks. The first is to see if I can make a mini cabin out of these Jenga blocks. The second will be a vertical climb test to determine how tall of an object the excavator is capable of climbing on top of. And three, a test of how long the battery lasts. The Jenga block cabin build is, in my opinion, a great way to show how precise you can be by making the smallest of movements, whether it be to realign a block you place or maneuver one into position for picking up. Overall though, I'm a little embarrassed to say just how long this took me, but hopefully you, the audience, can learn to become a far more efficient operator than I. Nonetheless though, I still had a blast doing it, and to top it off, I of course had to try out my hand at demolition. Moving on to the vertical climb test, our first obstacle will be this blue box measuring in at 2 inches, and for reference, the tracks on our excavator sit right about 1¾ inches. This proved to be an absolute walk in the park, and I honestly probably could have just tried driving straight forward after initially lifting my tracks up onto the box. Level 2 is this white box measuring in at 3 inches, and this is about where technique starts to matter, as you don't want to lift your tracks too high up onto the box initially, as that could result in a high center of gravity, aka tipping over. But once again, this really wasn't that difficult, and the excavator moved right up onto it with ease. Now level 3, the final level, is two of these filament boxes stacked on top of each other, measuring in at just under 6 inches, which is almost double the previous level. The approach to this one has to be a little bit more creative, as you can't initially place your tracks all the way on top. Instead, I went about halfway, then spun around and did a graceful faceplant, which allowed me to get my tracks to the top of the box. At this point, this is pretty much just an excavator push-up, in which I used my bucket tilt to get my tracks firmly planted, and then simultaneous combination of both the boom and dipper controls to push myself up, level with the top of the box. From there, it's as simple as driving forward. I've always thought this challenge would be so cool because it really shows just how capable excavators are. I mean, it's basically just a tank with a fully articulated arm. To celebrate my crowning achievement, I descended down the other side and on to the final test. All right, I have my mini excavator ready to go. I've got a table full of stuff that I can move around. It's time to do an official battery life test. And so, without further ado, I'm gonna go ahead and flip our excavator on and start our timer. Now this whole bit is pretty self-explanatory, but let me just say that it was still an absolute blast. To start, I decided to stack these blue blocks as high as I could, then play a little bit of tug of war with the mini dump truck. Then I started to move this skid steer around, but ultimately got distracted by other creative possibilities, like knocking over the blue blocks and picking up this ramp to make a bridge.
All right, I went ahead and stopped the timer, not because it was totally dead, but I could definitely tell it was starting to get a little bit weak on power. So I'm just gonna assume the batteries are pretty low at this point. And I think it's a safe bet to say that you're gonna get anywhere between, at the very minimum, you're gonna get at least 25 to 30 minutes of runtime. So I think for a little mini excavator, that's not too bad. And then all you have to do to recharge it is just take these batteries out, plug them in via micro USB, wait for them to charge, which doesn't take very long at all, plug them back in and you're good to go. Or if you have a backup set of them, you can just pull these out, put the new ones in, and you're right back off to the races again. So if you want to 3D print and build your own mini RC excavator in whatever filament color you choose, the files are of course free on printables. And then I have a step-by-step guide that will take you through ordering the circuit boards, what electronics you'll need, and how to code the microcontroller, etc., which you can unlock by becoming a Professor Boots Workshop member on my website, which will also give you access to a couple extra attachments in the near future. It supports the channel a ton and really helps to continue funding the development of these 3D printable educational RC projects. Now, of course, just like with the mini dump truck and this mini excavator, you, the audience, get to choose the next project by commenting down below what project you want to see next. Each individual comment gets counted as one vote, and whatever piece of equipment, such as a dozer or a forklift or a semi-truck, etc., has the most comments will be the next project. As always, thank you so much for watching, and perhaps I'll see you again here soon with some more special attachments you can 3D print for your RC excavator. Oh.